Hello, everybody, and welcome to the TV Enthusiast discussion of Arrow, The Flash, and Marvel's Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. Of course, we're going to be talking about other things as well. We're going to be talking about things in the Marvel Cinematic Universe as we do more of these episodes. But right now, our focus is going to be on those three shows because that's what's on right now. The name of this series of videos that we produce is TVE, meaning TV Enthusiast, versus Marvel and DC. This is our second episode. In it, we are going to be talking about the third episode of the third season of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. and the second episode of the fourth season of Arrow and the second episode of the second season of The Flash. So that's a lot of numbers.
You said the third episode of Arrow, or?
It's the second, I believe.
The second, okay, yeah, that's what I thought.
It's the third episode of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. this season.
Okay, just wanted to make sure I didn't mishear you there.
Yeah, Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. started 1 week before. So they're one episode further ahead. Okay, so we're going to start off with Marvel's Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. The episode in question, the third episode of the third season, is called A Wanted Inhuman, with the inhu in parentheses. This episode is primarily about Lincoln being pursued by both S.H.I.E.L.D. and this task force, this new task force that's ominous and hunting all of the Inhumans down. And we get to see as he reaches out to Daisy, or previously Sky, to help him out.
Yep.
So
Lincoln doesn't reach out to Sky. Sky reaches out to him, and he's kind of avoiding her.
But he does call her and say that he needs her help after he ends up killing the guy.
I think, after he kills the guy, he kind of realizes that.
He gets betrayed by a friend, and he tries to kind of clear a path to get away from him and ends up accidentally killing his friend. His friend has like a heart attack.
Right, yep, has a heart attack after seeing what he can do up close and personal.
And he can't revive him even with his powers, so.
Yeah. So he's gone.
Yeah. And so it's a race between this new task force and S.H.I.E.L.D. now that Daisy's been contacted to secure Lincoln first.
Right.
But things don't necessarily go too well according to Daisy's plans there.
No, because it turns out that this task force knows about Daisy too, and they kind of give S.H.I.E.L.D. an ultimatum, you know, and so basically S.H.I.E.L.D. decides, or Coulson basically decides that he wants to protect Daisy over Lincoln
or other Inhumans in general,
probably. And so, like, you know, because he has that connection, Daisy is too important, so he decides to hand over Lincoln in exchange for Daisy. And then, you know,
even this doesn't go as planned.
Because Lincoln still escapes, and then they try to take Daisy into custody anyway. And then that's basically when Coulson decides as a last resort to offer himself or his team, and their knowledge.
Mm-hmm. Which kind of seems like weird that it's a last resort, because he'd been reaching out to tell them he would help them all along.
Yeah, I know.
The whole time he's been like, I'll help you, but we have to do this a different way. I'll help you. And then now that he's like contracted there, he's still talking to her. But we have to do this a different way. And it's like, so really, like, what did you offer?
Yeah. I guess, like, when it's that, I don't, like, get that part. it was like, okay, it's like probably one of those things where the writers had kind of written themselves into a corner.
Mm-hmm.
So they were like, you can just tell they needed a way out.
So yeah, that's kind of one of the three stories of the episode. We also got to see Lance and May in their pursuit of Ward and Hydra.
Yes. this was good seeing like the interplay between May and Lance, because they're like such different characters. Like Lance is like this jokester, you know, he doesn't seem to take anything seriously, even though I think he just jokes around to compensate, you know. But
he kind of keeps his darkness on the inside, whereas May kind of like exposes it on the outside.
Yeah, May exposes it. She's like all serious. She's all business. And so it's fun to get these two characters together, because it's almost like oil and water mixing, you know.
So the probably the funniest part of this episode, and it was directly related to this, is they finally meet up with one of Lance's like old drinking buddies.
Yes.
And they're at a bar and they're drinking and they have to do business, but they're drinking first. And May makes the comment that as if they're, you know, not hard enough to listen to already with their accents, you know. And then it cuts to them like already drunk talking, and it's all subtitle.
That was a good scene.
It was a good little gag there that they did on the show. So I enjoyed that. And then the way that storyline progresses is they end up finding out that Lance has to join Fight Club.
Mm-hmm. We all talk about Fight Club. Lance has to join Fight Club. He thinks he's going to do well. He said if need be, he can take punches until the other guy passes out.
But he gets a little nasty surprise in who his opponent is going to be.
Yeah.
And what his friend thought of him all along. So turns out his old drinking buddy isn't exactly doesn't really think too well of him.
No. I can't see why. At all.
And so his old buddy plans to kind of just kill him off in this Fight Club.
Yes.
And sends some goons out to kind of keep May busy, which, you know, of course, didn't last very long. And Lance ends up kind of winning. I think it's implied he killed him. He ended up killing his old
buddy. Yeah, it's implied because...
They said he wasn't breathing, and then they didn't say anything past that.
Yeah, and May didn't look too happy at the end there after the fight was over either.
Yeah.
So I think it's implied that he did kill him in the end, which May had her own moment where she got accosted by some of the goons, and she ended up handily handing them their asses. You know, doing much better job than Lance.
Yeah, Lance isn't exactly a fighter on S.H.I.E.L.D. He's more just a fun character, I guess. I mean, his job, I guess, is to be a fighter, but he's not kind of at the same level as May. But yeah, basically...
That's kind of the
majority of that storyline. It does end with Lance meeting Ward's new right-hand man and setting up kind of he's kind of got his in with Hydra.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And so that's that story. The one other story that we had in Marvel's Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. is the one I enjoyed the most, besides, you know, some of the humor from Lance's story, which is Fitz and Simmons.
Fitz and Simmons, that continues to be a good story. They had that nice scene where they're at the restaurant that they were going to go to before Simmons got sucked into that monolith. Mm-hmm. They finally went on that date. And
you find out Fitz has been holding that reservation ever since.
Yeah, he's been holding that reservation ever since. Because he, I guess, you know, he just held out that much hope that he would get her back.
Mm-hmm.
Which was, like, really sweet. But, you know, then Simmons, of course, because of her trauma, she has a little breakdown. And Fitz is there to comfort her. And it's just a really nice scene, really nice character moments with those two characters, you know.
Yeah, I really like what they've been doing with the Fitz-Simmons relationship through the whole series. But, I mean, like, I like the concept of what they were trying to do with them through the whole series, but kind of what they were doing in the second season wasn't really necessarily hitting as well as I'd like. It's hitting like all the right notes.
Yeah.
They're nailing it.
This seems more honest than anything. Mm-hmm. Like that whole, like what they were doing like last season and stuff with their kid, like the will they, won't they, are they friends? That seemed like a bit dishonest. You know, you can tell when a TV show is like playing up, you know, relationships. TV shows do that all the time, and if it in like each time it feels a bit dishonest, you know, whereas this, what they're doing now, this actually feels honest, this feels real, and I really enjoy that and appreciate it.
I'm also a really big fan of consequences and storytelling when like you have kind of a big event happen and then you dwell on the consequences, you know?
Right. Yeah.
And you really give weight to it. I think Breaking Bad, of course, was amazing at doing that. Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., you know, we haven't really seen them do too much along those lines, you know? They'll have huge things happen and it kind of just moves on usually.
Mm-hmm. So
it's really nice to see consequences really in play with Simmons and what she went through, and they're not just resolving it. I like that they resolved the physical problem of where she was very quickly, but it's not over. Like, it's still continuing on past that.
Yeah, I like the fact that she didn't just jump up the monolith and say, "Oh, yay, hey guys, I'm back. Everything's cool." And
where are we going to next?
Yeah, where are we going to next? What?
Okay, so we're going to move on. Do you have any other comments about Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. this week?
I think that covers everything from this episode, doesn't it?
Yeah, pretty much. So we're going to move on now to the DC side of things, and we're going to start off with The Flash. The episode we're going to be talking about here is Episode 2 of Season 2, Flash of Two Worlds is the name of the episode, in which Jay teaches Barry how to throw lightning.
Yes, that was awesome.
Very comic booky. It's always great to get more along those lines.
Oh, yeah, definitely. I love the fact, one of the things I love about Flash is the fact that it embraces its comic book roots so much. It doesn't try to shy away from being a comic book like, you know, most things do, because, you know, like in the past, it would be like, oh, we have to be either super goofy or super gritty, one or the other. I think Flash falls squarely in the middle of that spectrum.
Yeah, it doesn't take itself too seriously, but it also doesn't make a mockery of itself, which is good. And what wasn't so good, though, was the whole team's reaction to Jay Garrett, their constant doubt, and then, you know, he mentions a helmet, and they're like, a helmet? Oh, okay, then. You must be talking about this one helmet, and if you're talking about that one helmet, then even though it just came through a portal and we have no other reason, we instantly trust you.
Trust gained.
So, that was a little rough, you know. Flash has a few rough edges along those lines.
Yeah, I didn't like the whole beginning of the episode where they're like, oh, I don't trust you.
Plus, yeah, and Barry being all moody and angsty, which is just not
right.
We don't want brooding Barry.
No, what What was fun is when they actually teamed up to take on the villain.
Jay, of course, without any abilities.
Yeah, Jay, of course, without any abilities, unfortunately. But it was still a cool superhero team up. And I was blown away when they actually referenced that cover in episode. Mm-hmm. Like, I didn't think they were going to do that.
Because we had the poster for it, and then we actually got the thing.
Yeah.
That all relates to another storyline that was kind of going on the undercurrent of this episode, which is a new female officer that's pursuing a place on the task force.
Yes.
So what are your thoughts, Will? Friend or foe?
Friend.
Invented foe, maybe? No? Friend?
I think friend. I think genuine friend. She seems too genuine. And also potential love interest for Barry Allen. Seems that way.
Just so they can stretch out the and cause problems with the will they, won't they with Iris again.
Yeah, again. I mean, it seems like that. They're certainly playing it up like that.
So yeah, let's see some other storylines we got going in that episode. Sisko uses his new psychic metahuman powers, and it couldn't make him more angsty.
Yeah, I know.
He's acting very Smallville about it. He thinks he's like a meteor rock freak, a meteor freak, you know? He's like,
well, he was like,
don't let them know I'm a meteor freak. You mean metahuman? Yeah, whatever.
Yeah, whatever. Wells said he gave me these powers, and Wells was evil, so nothing from him could possibly be good. And it was like, that's his reasoning.
Some guy should like walk up to him and say, you know, like, my great grandfather was a Nazi. Are you saying that makes me evil just because of my blood?
I know.
Just like ridiculous, but don't go that Smallville route of like hiding stuff from everybody to increase tension. That's so cheap.
Oh, they're gonna do that. They already did that in Arrow. They're not below, they're not above doing that.
Yeah, it's unfortunate though. That's not a good trait.
And it was like ridiculously handled in Arrow too. It was like somebody super important to Laurel's father died, and everybody's response is, let's just hide it from him because he might have a heart attack upon learning. and then at the end of the season, he finds out, and no heart attacks happen. So
they should have just abducted him and used
good like, job, Laurel.
Put him under, like, got him like really stoned or something, and laid back, and then told him.
No. It was like the flimsiest reasoning to keep that a secret. And it caused like so much unnecessary angst for the entire season. And in the span of that season, she literally told every other character on the show whether they had a need to know or not. It was like, oh my God, why are they dragging this out?
Oh God. I hate those storylines. It's like, yeah, that's painful. And Sisko's a great character, so just, God, we're going to do that. You know, Sisko has a dark secret story. It's like,
yeah, no. I hope they don't drag this out. And then fairly quickly so we can move on and have Sisko go back to being a fun character again.
We got one other kind of thing happening in this episode, which is we got to see a Dr. Stein collapse.
He collapsed for some reason at the end of the episode. Before he noted that there were like, we thought there was like one breach that connected the two universes. We thought there was like one major breach that stuff was coming through, but then he noted there's tons of breaches all over the city, including one inside of Star Labs. The biggest one is inside Star Labs, which might explain how Jay Garrick waltzed through in the last episode, despite like them hyping up all the security they set up.
Especially considering he doesn't have any powers anymore, and yeah.
Yeah. So Star Labs is not secure, so They just said they just in the span of two episodes, they derided the fact that they had people walk in throughout the entirety of last season, and then they set it up so that they can just have it happen in this season. Just now they have a plausible explanation.
Plot device.
I see what you did there, writers.
Hey, at least they're poking fun at the fact that they did it. So
yeah, right, exactly. But for some reason after that, Stein collapses, and we don't know why.
It's almost assuredly going to be related, of course, to Firestorm. His partner being gone, and that this will probably be a way that they either bring him back or resolve that in some weird way.
Well, there was an even bigger reveal in this episode, in which at the end of the episode, we actually got to see a glimpse of Earth 2, Jay Garrick's Earth. Mm-hmm. And in there, we saw Earth 2 Star Labs and the head of Star Labs, you know. Dun dun dun. Wells.
Harrison Wells, yeah.
Harrison Wells.
But is that Harrison Wells? World. Is that Harrison Wells, or is that what's his name? Who took Harrison Wells' place?
That's a good question. It could go either way. It could actually be Harrison Wells, or it could be Earth 2 Reverse Flash.
Yeah. Because it seems to be pointing in the direction, like, this is a creepy moment because Harrison Wells was the Reverse Flash. It's like, but Harrison Wells really wasn't the Reverse Flash. That was kind of like the twist last season.
Yeah. Harrison Wells was an actual person and wasn't the Reverse Flash. So.
But he was the iconic face of the character, and when like the you know, if you're gonna want to bring back that kind of villainous role, he's the one you want to bring it back through, not through the other actor who played.
Yeah,
the actual Reverse Flash, you know,
the actual Eobard. Yeah, I don't know if they're gonna do it that way because we got Zoom now.
Yeah.
But
could be something completely different. He could be a benevolent character.
Yeah.
That's just save those people. And I mean, that's kind of what Harrison Wells was played up to be, before he was murdered. So, I mean, it wasn't Harrison Wells that did anything wrong in The Flash. That was all.
That was all Eobard.
Yeah.
So it looks like. Glad to see that actor back. Glad to see that character back.
I know he's going to come back. He's like the Lex Luthor from Smallville on the show. You know?
Yeah, I know, right?
They got to have something like that. So yeah. Let's move on. And do you have anything else to talk about with The Flash?
Just that I'm looking forward to next week. It's been super fun for these two episodes.
You're looking forward to it. Kat's exasperated.
Yeah, because of like the wonky science stuff. They're not really, you know. I mean, yeah, if you're looking for scientific accuracy, this is not your show. I will admit, it's a lot, and a lot of stuff is just plain dumb.
Yeah.
But what they're doing is so fun, and the execution is so fun that it's forgivable. The dumb stuff is forgivable or easily overlooked. It's because, you know.
Yeah. Let's talk about Arrow then, closely related to The Flash, of course, takes place in the same universe. The episode in question we are talking about today is The Candidate, which is episode 2 of season 4. So this episode starts out with a family friend of the Queen's running for mayor. And she gets targeted by this evil group they've been pursuing, the Ghosts, the Hive.
Yes, led by Damian Dark. But Damian Dark doesn't use his ghost or his organization to do this. He contracts an outsider, basically a guy by the name of Anarchy, mm-hmm. whose methods ends up not liking.
I laughed at the end when they had like the Anarchy symbol painted, yeah. and the guy said, "What's that symbol mean?" And it's like, really?
Oh yeah, I know.
Oh, my word. Who doesn't know what the Anarchy symbol is?
What's you know? That? Oh, I don't know. Just teenagers have been running around with it on their T-shirts for ages.
I've never been to Hot Topic in my entire life. What does that symbol mean? So, yeah, but she's being, her daughter is abducted.
Yes.
And threatened.
To force her to quit her bid for mayor. Because mm-hmm. the initial assassination attempt didn't work because of somebody named Oliver Queen got in the way.
It was great, Oliver, like going like, "Oh, my martial arts classes or something," to like try to explain.
And he's like, "Oh, I took self defense classes. Don't worry."
And then he jumps off the fucking balcony or whatever.
That's funny. Yeah, that's funny. So Anarchy resorts to kidnapping. Which yeah. Damien Dark does not approve of at all. Which
everything we've seen from Damien Dark so far goes like, well, why would he have a problem with that?
I know, right?
but he's all like, there's a line. It's like, but destroying the entire city and everybody in it doesn't cross that line?
No.
There's children in the city, too.
Because the city has to die. I don't know. It's
Arrow. That's a little inconsistent, you know.
Arrow villain logic, I guess.
Yeah.
Well, destroying cities is fine. Kidnapping's bad. Come on. It's like the big bad guy going, okay, I'm going to murder thousands of people, but even I have morals. Come on.
Yeah, don't jaywalk. That crosses a line. I'd never cross. Literally, it crosses the line.
But it looks like Anarchy gets away at the end of the episode, so it looks like he's going to have a bigger arc or a bigger story.
He's moving over to Gotham.
Oh, yeah, that's true. Yeah.
They need, every time a new villain is created, they move over to Gotham.
They move over to Gotham. Gotham needs more villains.
that's the name of my new band, Gotham Needs Villains. No, but yeah, besides that storyline, we got Felicity struggling with downsizing.
Yes.
What's it? Palmer Corporation? What's it called?
Palmer, yeah. I think that Palmer Industries or something like that.
Yeah, which she is running in place of her her old boyfriend.
Yes. Presumed dead, but we know is just microscopic at the moment.
The Atom. Felicity's struggling with having to downsize people. A few kind of stupid little gags in here with her, like, you know, laying off was at the 12 people, and they say, oh, that page is double-sided.
Yeah, that page is double-sided.
Oh!
This does bring us the introduction of a major new character to the show, though.
Yes.
Curtis Holt,
a.k.a. Felicity's new friend.
A.k.a. Mr. Terrific. Who happens to be another superhero in the DC universe.
Yeah, and this is who Felicity's riding her hopes on to come up with a miraculous solution to save the day. He is in charge. He is the new manager of the Deus Ex Machina division.
Yes, the Deus Ex Machina division. Well, she basically like lies to the board and says like he has like some device he made.
Yeah,
that's gonna save everything when he has no such thing at the moment. But she just goes to him and is like, well, you're just going to make it.
Well, at this point, I mean, what does it hurt? What does a lie hurt? You know, I mean, you can only do it once, but at that point.
Yeah, at that point, right?
Thea's been acting a little bit crazy over the last couple episodes. I think I mentioned it last week that Thea's all bloodlusty and nuts.
Well, we knew that there was going to be after effects from Lazarus Pit because, well, they said so. They came. Yeah. It's like they didn't even hint at it. They just had a major character say, "Well, you come out of that, you're changed."
It's like we believed there was going to be that problem when the show creator came out and said there would be.
Yes, pretty much. So I mean, it's nice though that they did like make it like a subtle, like a gradual type change. You know, instead
yeah, it seems like her problem is that she just, like, as adrenaline pumps into her system, she just loses control.
Yeah, she just kind of sort of like Roy.
She gets real itty.
Sort of like Roy when he was like on the Murakuru.
Yeah, yeah. Except he was kind of like always paranoid.
Yeah, he was like that. That was like a much stronger effect than the Murakuru. Yes,
but I wonder if they're gonna like try to tie those together at some point. Like Mercury is like a artificial version of something that is related to the
Lazarus Pit.
Yeah,
or they're gonna do some kind of weird thing. That's not a bad idea, actually.
Side effects are similar. So
side effects that would actually make sense as far as where Mercury came from.
Murakuru is like, you know, it's Japanese and you have this kind of, you know, weird oriental thing going on with a whole League of Shadows and stuff. And so,
yeah, Neil McDonough is Damien Dark again. He just kills it in that role. Mostly just because of like Neil McDonough's charisma. He just like oozes this charisma where he can play like these great villains.
Very fun villains. You mentioned last week when we were talking about his role in Justified.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. And he's great at playing villains, he's great at playing heroes. Not necessarily like leading men heroes, but great at like, you know, like Dum Dum in the MCU.
Yeah,
Dum
Dum in the MCU, yeah.
So he's somebody we like to see, and so far he's much more impactful than Roz was last season.
Oh, Roz was like, as far as the villain goes, he was just boring. He was a snooze fest. It was like,
yeah, Damien Dark is like seems much more along the lines of kind of maybe what we expected from a Roz, you know, being this kind of almost unstoppable, seemingly unstoppable force.
Right, seemingly unstoppable force. He makes it. This is definitely a return to the kind of villains Arrow traditionally had, whereas, you know, season one, Malcolm Merlyn, the guy who plays Malcolm Merlyn, you know, John Barrowman, he plays him so good, he was so charismatic, that they actually just kept his character around for the rest of the series. He was that good. And then, of course, you had Deathstroke. Again, another fantastic performance. Fantastic.
Oh, yeah.
Fantastic. Manu Bennett. Yeah, just fantastic. Just great. Awesome. Yeah. And then you get to Roz, and it's so flat and boring and lifeless. And it's like, I think that also helped to drag season three down.
Yeah, definitely. Especially in the second half. I think in the first half, there's a little bit more mystery to Roz, and it made him a little bit more interesting.
Yeah, he was interesting when he was mysterious. But then when all the mystery was stripped away, and you just had this flat, boring character.
Yeah.
You just wanted it to end.
So what we're saying is hopefully they don't do that with Damien Dark.
Hopefully they don't. So far, Damien Dark seems to be a return to the fun, charismatic villains that this show was known for.
Also, unlike Roz, he's been confirmed for both The Flash and Legends of Tomorrow.
Yeah, that's going to be interesting.
So it'll be cool to see kind of where they take him with that.
See him go head to head with Barry Allen.
But the point of bringing up Thea's struggles post Lazarus Pit is that Oliver finally revealed that truth to Thea and everybody else in the group, and not just about the Lazarus pit for Thea, but about the potential side effects that he was warned of.
Right.
And so this kind of catches Laurel by a bit of surprise. She's like, what's this? Return from the dead.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Magic return from the dead pit. So she digs up her sister's corpse to take it to Nanda Parbat. Which, this is such a cop-out. How does this even work? Because her sister has been rotting for, like, months now.
Yeah. It's like,
Thea was put in the pit, like, literally, right after she was stabbed. You know, there wasn't, like, a lot of time between Thea, you know, if she even died,
mm-hmm.
which wasn't even confirmed. She was, like, as far as we know, when she was put in the pit, she was near death. Laurel's sister Sarah has been well and truly dead for ages now in Showtime.
Yeah.
They just throw a skeleton in there and that comes back as a living person. I mean, I didn't know that's how the Lazarus pit worked.
Well, it didn't look that rotted from the...
I think they cheated a little bit. But, yeah.
What we're going to have to do here is... I think it's going to end up being a little bit more than the Lazarus pit, because we know, for example, that Constantine is supposed to have some involvement in this process.
That's true. Constantine shows up for an episode, and this is probably what he's there for.
Episode 3 is this coming up week. That's when they're kind of going out to League of Shadows. But then episode 4, I believe, is when Constantine's supposed to appear.
Because we know that Sarah's supposed to come back. Legends of Tomorrow confirms that.
Mm-hmm.
So we know a lot of things happening in Arrow and Flash right now are setting up for Legends of Tomorrow. But the thing is, to bring Sarah back, because of the length of time she's been dead, they got like a big hill to climb there.
Yeah.
And so it's interesting to see how they can do this and make it plausible.
I wonder if what they're going to do is something like Roz will say, you know, the new Roz.
Malcolm Merlin?
Malcolm Mer-Roz. We'll basically tell them it's not doable because the spirits left the body or something. And the spirit still had to be in the body for it to happen. And then, of course...
Constantine,
one of his skills is he's a medium, so you know that could go into kind of bringing the spirit back into the body,
right? Yeah, that could
so there could be something along those lines, you know. We'll have to see how that introduces, you know. They're saying this is the only Constantine episode this season,
right? But then you're just bringing him back for this one performance. Because obviously there wasn't any major plans for this, because it was like a tentative thing to where, you know, it could have fallen apart. So they, of course, nobody writing Arrow would want to devote a huge chunk of the season to this character on the off chance that they were able to get it, you know?
Well, the interesting thing here is that in the DC movie universe, they were considering doing Justice League Dark, is it called? With Guillermo del Toro attached. And everything we've heard about that so far seems to be that it's not going to happen now.
That's a shame.
That would be a kind of cool thing they might be able to do by bringing in Constantine through Arrow and some of the more kind of mystical elements. What if they did a CW show or something and did Justice League Dark?
Poor Guillermo, but everything he's involved with currently seems to be cursed.
games, at least, and now this, but...
And now this, yeah.
I mean, it's anything when he's attached to something that's not his own.
Yeah, that's not his own. Yeah, exactly.
That would be kind of cool if they did like something, you know, like a kind of a second shot at doing Constantine by doing it a show that's not just about Constantine, but about like a whole group.
They could definitely do that.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
I totally dig that, because I like the kind of comic booky stuff. that leans more towards kind of the darker, you know what I mean? That kind of
right. Well, that's what I was talking about.
Fall show, yeah.
And that was what I was talking about on the podcast when I thought that Marvel should probably get into Blade or Ghost Rider, do that sort of Midnight Suns type, you know, comic booky supernatural type stuff, which I think would make for really fun material, like maybe as like a Netflix series or something.
Yeah, it's I still say that I think that's it's just too much with everything else going on in the MCU.
Right.
But I think it would be cool if they did what else we were talking about, is if they created like a separate universe and then found a way to cross them.
Right.
I think that would be really cool.
That could be cool too.
Bring DC into, why not? Star right. Wars. You know, Once Upon a Time comes in.
Yeah, Once Upon a Time
comes in. Saw Sesame Street. Doesn't matter. Just bring it all in.
Just bring it all in. All
the TARDIS shows up. Doctor Who comes out. Yeah.
I know, right? The TARDIS show.
They're all like, we need some kind of a box that's bigger on the inside. And you hear the...
Okay. Wow.
Who's this British guy? So yeah, Laurel's taking Thea and the corpse of Sarah to the League of Shadows. And they're going to try to revive her sister and figure out what's going on with the side effects of the Lazarus Pit. Which hopefully means next episode we get to see John Barrowman again.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to that. Well, I think definitely. I mean, come on. He's been a fixture of the show for the entire run. They're not just going to drop his character now.
Yeah. Well, we know we're going to see him again. It's just hopefully we get to see him next episode.
Hopefully we get to see him next episode. Yeah. Especially as the new Roz. I just want to see him like be all cocky and be like, yeah, I'm Roz Al Ghul now.
Yeah. Kneel and kiss the ring.
He will definitely be a more charismatic and animated Roz Al Ghul than the last guy.
So there's another kind of a big kind of twist moment at the end of the episode that's kind of setting up. I honestly kind of laughed when he said it, but Oliver is now running for mayor.
They're doing it. They're doing they're doing the storyline from the comic books where Oliver Queen becomes mayor of Star City. and apparently Oliver Queen as mayor does not F around.
It's just funny the way they're gonna pursue this, you know.
It is. I was wondering because I knew they already did that in the comic books, you know, and I was wondering if they would ever get to it in the show. But I thought that was like going to be way way down the line if they ever did that, and it looks like they're just gonna go ahead and do it. And I kind of predicted it in the middle of this episode too, because they were kind of pointing out, you know, all the other mayors were dead because they kept going after them, and then now this woman went up for mayor and she had to quit. And I'm like thinking, well, why does Oliver just do it? And you know, they can't get him because he's the Green Arrow, so he can protect himself.
It's kind of funny if you think about it though, because if you strip away all the stuff that nobody in the city knows about Oliver, all the Green Arrow stuff, you take all of that outside, and then you take the Oliver Queen as people know him in his city to be running. It's kind of funny because it's like, oh, this guy is running for mayor. Wait, isn't he that rich billionaire that was like a womanizer and disappeared and was on an island for 3 years, then mysteriously came back, and then, like, you know, his family suffered a bunch of tragedy, and then he like took over his business and lost it like instantly.
So apparently in the comic books, this is basically what he does with his office. First of all, he uses an open interpretation of the town charter to perform same-sex marriages in Star City.
He performs them? Doesn't like just legalize it or do something along those lines?
I don't know. The wiki here says to perform. But I think legalize is what they mean.
he's all there. There's a huge threat. Damien Dark, he's going to kill everybody. Bring in the next pair of grooms.
he also exercises the power of his office to do such things as blackmail corrupt businessmen or have the Star City SWAT team back up his actions as Green Arrow while he publicly condemns his alter ego.
That sounds like season one Oliver Queen, the blackmailing stuff. That's the kind of stuff we saw in season one and a little bit in season two that we haven't seen in a while, is these weird little connections he made, like with Russian gangsters and stuff.
Right. It says he also amasses a large personal fortune by manipulating the stocks of companies he sees as unscrupulous.
Yeah. So that's funny. We're going to have Mayor Oliver.
Yeah, we're going to have Mayor Oliver Queen now. So that, yeah, it's totally, again, it's like what they're doing with The Flash now. It seems they're totally embracing the comic books and the storylines that happened in the comic books. Mayor Oliver Queen is like the biggest sign of them doing that. So that's going to be fun to see. I'm looking forward to that. When he wins, if they have him, it'll be such a cop out if they have him lose in the show. Because I want to see him win, and I want to see what they do with that. Because I think that would be interesting.
I just can't wait for the episode where they do like a debate or something. They're like, "What qualifications do you have? You lost your business like right away. You're just a screw up and a failure. Why should we vote for you?" And he'll say, like, "Because I believe in this city," and everyone will clap. And
he'll just take off his shirt and say, "Because look at these abs."
Just look at them. You'll just see everybody's eyes, like, swirling like they're hypnotized.
Hours on hours on the salmon ladder.
So we also got in this episode a flashback again. You know, they always do the flashbacks every season throughout the episodes. It's just feeling kind of like the flashbacks now. Like it's going towards more relevant material by going back to the island, which is nice. But it feels more and more like throwaway now, you know?
It is actually the flashbacks now. From the direction it seems to be, again, this is more material lifted from the comics. This time the flashbacks seem to be adapting Green Arrow Year One, the Year One comic, it was like they were like doing for Green Arrow what they did for Batman when they did the Batman Year One comic, which was reboot his origin and try to add a little more depth to Green Arrow's origin. By basically saying while he was on the island, this story was like while Green Arrow was on the island, after he learned his skills, he had to take out some drug lords who were operating on the island. And it seems to be what they're doing, essentially.
He's infiltrating this group, which it just seems so easy for him. Like, we're going to send you to infiltrate. He gets sent. He gets caught like immediately. And then gets invited to join. That Oliver Queen is a skilled operator.
We know
he got right in there.
So this is getting close to when he finally comes back to the city and becomes Green Arrow. We know there's at least one more year of flashbacks to go because he was 5 years on the island. This would be year four that he was missing. And so we got this little adventure. Plus
your five will be like Castaway. He'll just be on the island with like a beach ball, volleyball, like with a face on it.
I know. But if we're in season six and we're still having flashbacks to some adventure he had in the past that was before the series, I am going to call shenanigans.
No, see, what's going to happen is after season five, at the end of season five, there's going to be a big time jump.
Yeah.
And then they'll flash back to moments in the time jump.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, they'll pull it once upon a time where they'll just the main storyline will jump 5 years in the future, and then there'll be flashbacks to the missing 5 years.
Yeah. I mean, well, that's, you know, it's happened before. It'll happen again. So
or at the beginning of season six, Oliver will be like Oliver will be talking to Diggle. Diggle will be confronting him, and Oliver will be like, "We have to go back, Diggle. The island. We have to go back."
Flash forwards on Arrow would kind of make sense. We did kind of get something like a flash forward at the end of the last week's episode, in which we found out that Oliver is very sadly mourning Felicity's omelet.
Yeah, we did get a flash forward on Arrow, so but maybe we will start doing flash forwards now. You're right.
But that pretty much brings us to an end on Arrow, unless you have any other final words on that episode.
Nope.
So yeah, this is kind of what we're going to be covering these three shows every week. Next week, maybe we'll have Ed on. We were trying to get him on this week. It didn't kind of pan out, unfortunately. But he said he's interested, so we might get him on. Maybe sometime later on we'll be able to bring Kat in. So stay tuned. This is TVE versus Marvel and DC, episode number 2, discussing the third episode of the third season of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., the second episode of the second season of The Flash, and the second episode of the fourth season of Arrow. So thank you, everybody, for watching. Check us out at TVEnthusiast.com. Check out the rest of our videos on YouTube. You can see us, Will and I, discussing Hannibal and Game of Thrones, among other things. And, so thank you, everybody, for listening and watching. Bye.
Bye.